Hello， 大家好，今天我们在国家大剧院和几位熟悉的好朋友再次见面，让我们来一起来打个招呼吧。Hi, Andrew.
Hi, so nice.
Welcome back to AllenTalk.
So nice. To see you. Absolute pleasure. Thank you, Allen. Thank you.
Hi. Are you got a friend here?
Yeah, this is Francesca.
Yeah, please, Francesca. Could you please introduce yourself?
Hello, I'm Francesca de Lucia. I'm Italian and Swiss. And I teach English literature and writing at Minzu University in Beijing. And before I used to teach at Jushida with Andrea. And this is my fourth year in China.
Great, welcome. Oh, well, you know, last time we spoke, that was about more than half a year ago, right?
That's right,
so, how have you been doing ever since?
Incredibly busy, really, really busy, but happy being busy. After I saw you in Beijing last June, I believe.
Yep.
I went back to Jinhua, finished up there with the semester, and then I went to America for 2 months.
Yeah, I remember you mentioned that. Yeah. How was the trip?
I always find it very, very long because I have to catch three flights.
Oh, three flights,
wow. Yeah, exactly. Shanghai, LA, Atlanta, and then Fayetteville, North Carolina. Mm-hmm, so it's a long journey, but well worth it. It's an absolutely beautiful place. North Carolina is very pretty. It's very nice.
Great, great. Welcome back.
Thank you.
So what have you been working on recently?
Actually, I mentioned to you in the last time we had the conversation, but I was going to work on some new projects, new courses this year. So I started back in September, and I've been teaching some art students, some oral English, which is fantastic, really good. So I've learned a lot about Chinese art, and also introduced them to some Western art, mainly contemporary abstract arts, but obviously in English. So I really, really enjoyed that, and I feel they enjoyed it as well. So that was good. I also taught, I've been working on a new online course for undergraduate students, mainly undergraduate students who want to or studying to become a teacher, English teacher, mainly for elementary, middle, high school students. And it's an online course. And it's basically showing or trying to improve practical classroom English phrases, for example.
Okay, good. Can you give us some examples? Sounds really cool.
It is, actually, because these are kind of common phrases that I've heard with whether it's my students in class. And a lot of Chinese teachers use these phrases. So, for example, we have 15 units.
15 units.
Yes, so it's completely new. I believe nobody else has done it in China. Our university is pretty good.
So you pioneered in this.
Education department is pretty good and has a good reputation. And basically what it's saying is, look, you follow this online course, it's interactive, and teaching you how to use better phrases, basically native-like phrases.
Teach English teachers better phrases to use in the English classroom.
So
Francesca, you can also relate it to some of your experiences as well, right?
Yes, I mainly teach writing. I teach literature and writing, and various things are interesting, but one thing that's interesting and I find other students do, and they do it here in Beijing, they did it in Zhejiang, they use some set phrases. So they love saying, they love writing as we all know. If we all know it, why are you writing it? And sometimes it's things that it's not true that everyone knows. They would write in a word, but then they write maybe one paragraph, they write 10 more lines,
more than a word.
So these are the main offenders, so to speak, and then what's more, in a nutshell. And some students, they're kind of aware it's not the greatest practice, but for some it's very ingrained, and I wonder if they've been taught to use those phrases when we were in high school, when we were preparing to the Gaokao, what is the source of this?
Yeah. Now you're coming to the source here. The teacher who teaches
and the Chinese English teachers, right? How to use better phrases to teach the students, also to really, you know, to educate them. Yeah. As I was an English teacher, a student teacher also as well, before. Yeah. I was those phrases. I used some of them before. Either I was taught by my teachers or I read it from certain paragraphs before. So maybe in certain situations we didn't really comprehend those phrases very well. So mm-hmm. we just try using them, you know. Mm-hmm. Trying is no harm, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it's really important to be pointed out by the experts, teachers like you, right? Mm-hmm. How to use them better, how to use them in the proper way.
Mm-hmm.
So now how about we show some examples how we can use those certain phrases, either for the teachers or students, in a proper way or better way.
What I've heard and witnessed, whether it's with students or or Chinese teachers.
Okay, example one.
For example, they would say, "I want to share my happy family with you today."
Share my happy family with you today.
So I think, share what? What share? So I want to share your father and share your mother. This is my understanding as a native teacher. So share seems to be used a lot with Chinese teachers and students. And we don't say share. We can say, I would like to share maybe some photos of my family to you.
Oh, right? So you don't share people, right?
No.
You share items from your family with others.
Mm. Or experiences.
Or information.
Or feelings. Like I want to share my experience, the experience, the love I have for my family. Mm-hmm. But you don't, or I want to share, maybe you could say, oh, I really enjoyed this book and I want to share it with you.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
But not
people. An item, not people.
How can you share your mother? Is your mother, you're not, it's not like a cake you are going to cut and share.
But I can kind of understand as a Chinese, because actually the real meaning of that person was trying to express was to share the happiness, right? The happiness from the family.
Right, with you.
Because they wanted to share the happiness of those loved ones, right? People with you.
Mm.
But they mistakenly used the wrong phrase, right, to express the real meaning. Okay, thank you for pointing that out.
I also can say happy family too, and I think, okay, it's great that you think your family is happy, but I wouldn't, very rare we would say that. I think in the
West, you won't say, I have a happy family.
Yeah, of course, I know I have a happy family, but I want you to make your judgment, not influence your judgment by me saying happy family. I want you to decide by, for example, sharing photos.
I see. So I want to show you the photos, show you experience, stories, or books, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you decide, then you will make the judgment whether my family is happy or not.
Oh,
right?
Exactly. Okay. Yeah, I just find it a bit bizarre. But, you know, I understand it now that you've explained about
great.
The word share.
Thank you for pointing that out.
Okay.
Yeah, any other words you want to add?
I was thinking, I was wondering with the sharing if it's also some kind of Chinese phrase that it translated literally in a way that's not appropriate. Because I realize now I'm learning Chinese.
I can understand that. Your Hanyu is quite good.
The
Mandarin is quite good.
Anyway, but I remember when I first came to China, and you know, a lot of Chinese people, even some have excellent English, they mistake he or she. And with my students, I was kind of shocked, and I thought, at their level, this is a terrible mistake. But then, of course, I started learning Chinese, and it's a very understandable mistake.
And
now I understand maybe even people who maybe, they have PhDs in English literature and have been many years, I don't know, in the UK or America, why they make that mistake. So when I hear these expressions like, I would like to share my family or things like that, or another thing that sounds a bit strange is saying, as for my friends, they went to the cinema, as opposed to just saying, my friends went to the cinema.
Right.
or starting, like if it's something of a kind of literal translation from Chinese, something that would make sense in Chinese, but does not make so much sense in English.
I see.
Okay. That's new. You brought up two things actually just now. As a Chinese, I can kind of know better the resource of those mistakes. The first one, because you know Chinese in China, he and she pronounce the same in in Chinese, right? Ta. And I have a good practice to share with the audience. That's what I did.
Right. Yeah. Okay.
To how to really get used to, or better be able to distinguish he and she, and you have to practice because practice makes perfect.
Absolutely.
It takes time. Mm-hmm. When I was in school, the way I tried was whenever I was maybe walking along the street or took a bus, I would just look around all the people, then all the people around me, and then I would silently say it in my mind, in my head, he, she, her, him. I keep doing that. Whenever I see a male, I would say he, him. Then when a female, she, her, I would always have those words just instantly come to my mind. I have to keep practicing until you're able to really, you know, get used to it.
Yes.
Then that really helps you when you're speaking English. Like, okay, I'm sitting here with two ladies and she and he, him, right?
Yeah.
So this is a way I tried and it worked well. The second thing is, second thing you brought up is as for. As for actually in Chinese is 关于. It's about regarding,
right.
About,
or
speaking of. Actually, maybe in the proper English, bad English, like speaking of my friends. Oh, you know, they went somewhere. They went to the National Theater, right? So actually, they wanted to say,
my
speaking friends.
Went.
Yeah, my friends went somewhere. It maybe because of context. They suddenly, okay. Oh, you mentioned somebody or mentioned something. Oh, speaking of something, something or somebody or something happened.
Mm.
Yeah, maybe that's a better way to understand and improve it. Right.
But if you're doing, sometimes we do it also because I teach literature. And if you're saying something, okay, I'm going in this essay, let's say I'm going to talk, or in this exam question, I'm going to talk about Oliver Twist by Charles Dickens. And you start saying something, as for Oliver, he was an orphan. And okay, it's not, oh, by the way, we are talking about Oliver. Mm. Like, we know that the exam or the essay or whatever you're doing is about Oliver Twist. So, and definitely I'm glad you brought up that term because
it
makes sense.
Yeah.
And
totally.
I think that's why I think it's important to make and to, as foreigners, we have to make the effort to try to learn some Chinese.
Exactly, but you're right there. Yeah. Like you say, by learning Chinese, then we're understanding. Then, oh, okay, I get it now. Why they can't translate it like English?
Yeah.
You know, I understand it. But before, when you don't know any Chinese,
exactly. So learning Chinese can also help you better teach English.
Yeah, definitely.
Chinese students.
Yeah, yes. Absolutely, definitely.
Yes, nice. Thank you. Okay, another example.
Okay.
Thank you.
How do you say?
How to say, right?
Yes.
It's very common, Either teachers or students would say, how to say this, how to say that. What's wrong with this sentence, in your opinion?
Well, it's not grammatical. English is not very good. It's not a full, complete sentence. It's like, how can you say, or how do you say?
Yeah.
Or how do you pronounce this word?
Exactly.
You know, pronounce. But usually that's pretty common. It's like, how do you say?
Have you encountered this before?
Yes. And not only have I encountered, but I think I'm picking bad habits maybe because sometimes I can't find a word and I'm saying, we went to the, how to say, the National Field.
But the literal meaning is how to say. It's like how to say with your mouth, right? It's like you don't have to ask, right? But actually, the real meaning is how do you say something in certain language? Or how do you pronounce certain words?
Exactly. It's very common. It's very common phrase that is.
Yeah. Oh, and I was thinking another one. Have a try.
Yeah, have
Why
a try.
Why don't you have a try?
Yeah.
Have a what?
Have a try.
Oh, have a try, right? Yeah. Okay, in Chinese, have a try. So they use try as a noun. Actually, it's grammatically correct, but not commonly used. Maybe it's better to say, give a shot. try.
All right.
Try something,
okay,
right?
Okay.
Try something. Give it a try.
Mm-hmm. Give it a try. Yeah, mm-hmm. Not have a try.
Oh, mm-hmm. Just try. Mm-hmm. Why you can't try doing this? And then
yeah, yeah, mm. Very good. So mm. In English, it's better to say, try it.
Yeah.
Give a shot.
Yeah, try it. Yeah.
Give a try, but yeah. Never have a try. Yeah. Have this verb is wrong.
Yeah.
Nice.
Also, there's for example, clear.
Clear in the classroom,
mm.
Right?
Mm. So I'm clear. Thinking clear with a question mark. So it's a question. Clear. And I'm like,
maybe Mumbai?
Exactly, yeah. But it's not very commonly used in Western countries, right? I understand. As a teacher, if you say, okay, after I explain certain phrases, words, mm-hmm. then I say to my student, clear? 明白了吗?
right.
Are you clear?
Yeah. Right. Yes.
But if you just use one word, clear, it's just...
No, it's not correct.
It's not correct.
It's incorrect.
What's a better way to say?
Is it clear to you? Or are you clear? Or do you understand is another way, you know, mm-hmm. another phrase, you know, because clear is like, what's clear? I don't know what you're asking.
Yeah, the sky is clear.
You know, be more specific.
Exactly.
Because that's what happens. It's not.
So it's better to be more specific.
Mm-hmm.
You got it? You can also say, well, have you got it?
I don't really say it. I think it's an American.
American term, yeah.
You got it?
You got it? Okay, you got it. Do you understand? You got it? Do you understand?
Yeah. Is it clear? Yeah. Do you understand?
Yeah.
Or something I say a lot to my students is, am I making sense?
Am I making sense to you?
Yeah. Does it make sense? Yeah.
Do I make sense to you?
Yeah.
Does it make sense to you? Mm-hmm. Do you understand? Right. Mm-hmm. Nice.
Mm.
Then you can answer crystal clear.
Yeah. Which is going to confuse them even more, right? Very clear. But that's very common.
That's common, right? Crystal clear is very common.
Yeah.
Nice.
Definitely.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. So that's really brought me back to some memories, things that really, those phrases really happened in my classroom, either when I was a student or a teacher. Thank you. Any other ones?
I'm just thinking, sorry, maybe slightly off topic, but still covering the online course.
Okay.
Because the online course covers 15 units altogether. So for example, it will teach you how to use better phrases or native-like phrases in the classroom environment.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for example, taking attendance.
Taking attendance.
Mm. Mm-hmm. So, which, for example, when I was a small child, like primary or elementary
school.
That's
before the classroom, before the class begins, right?
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
They would take it. Usually, what's different, my experience, what I can understand with Chinese schools, like elementary, middle school, for example,
mm-hmm.
You take the register in the morning and in the afternoon.
Like before every class, they would usually ask person who was on. Well, if I translate it literally from Chinese into English,
sure.
Who was on duty that day, like a monitor to make sure every student was in the classroom, no one was absent. So
right.
That's the purpose of taking the register. Actually, mm-hmm. They would say call the roll. Call the names, right?
Right. No.
With a list of
exactly.
the names with your in a piece of paper.
Mm-hmm. Mm. I just heard you say. It was meant to say, call the roll.
Yeah, this is common
which is an American
Chinese
phrase. We don't
teachers.
Say it in the UK.
Uh-huh.
And it sounds like to me when you pronounce it, when you say it, it's like cod the roll, which is to me, I'm thinking of like fish eggs, cod roll. Right? so I know that's a bit of a problem with the two L's. They can't pronounce the double L's, you know. So
call
that's very
roll.
Common. Mm. It's quite difficult for...
Common pronunciation errors that
exactly,
Chinese English teachers make.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing, going back to classes taking the register, when I was in school, when I was a child, I think it still happens actually.
Mm-hmm.
Normally we tend to have the same teacher all day long. So we'd have one teacher that would teach us the core subjects like maths and English
mm-hmm.
and art and so on. And we would stay in that same class all day at a young age. Where I notice here
mm-hmm.
Some of the students will switch classes. You know, you'll have different teachers for English, for example, or mm-hmm. art, or maths, or Chinese.
Yep.
So that's what's different. So,
yeah,
so I understand if you're saying that the teachers will take a register every class because they're having different teachers,
but
right?
But I don't like.
It happens. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, of course.
Do you understand that?
But I don't know. At least when I was in high school, we also had you know, you have different teachers for each subject.
In high school, it was the
and
same.
Then obviously, so each of them takes the attendance at the beginning of each class. Yeah. Mm. Also, because sometimes, I don't know, people coming late or
exactly.
they leave early, so maybe they're here in one class. And
But my point is that they start, you know, in the UK, that you have the same teacher every day up until you're 11, 12 years old.
For all the courses?
Yes.
Wow.
So when you go into like what we call secondary school or grammar school or then high school, then they have different teachers, so they end up going to different classrooms. Mm-hmm. So then, of course, then that's why I see why it was really needed to take the register.
Yeah.
Not just because they might skip class or whatever, it could be like kind of a fire or something like that. So that's really important.
Yeah, make sure you know who's there.
No one is left behind.
Exactly, you know. And then also how we take the register, the phrases are different.
Uh-huh.
So like you say, call the roll. It's like, okay, listen up, I'm going to take the register. Or if you hear your name, say yes, sir, or yes, here, I'm here, or just yes, or present, or just here. So
but not down in Chinese.
Exactly.
Chinese
is it just
what? Down means it. I'm here.
Arrived.
Yeah. And so down.
Yeah.
Allen Rao.
Yeah.
Down means present. Yeah. I'm here. Okay. I see. That's a good point. Thank you.
So that's the education system is different in that sense, you know, the phrases are different as well. Okay, I'm just thinking what else.
Anything else? Francesco, with your experience, anything else you want to add?
Well, I don't know, I find also sometimes the way people look for words, you know, if they're looking for words in the dictionary and then they don't always choose the most appropriate word.
Mm-hmm.
So for instance, once I had a student, she was doing a presentation on Chinese Americans.
Chinese Americans?
Yeah, Chinese in the United States. And she says at one point, oh, there is a lot of miscegenation going on right now.
Mm.
And miscegenation, it's a very negative word to indicate interracial relations. It has racist implications. So I told her that and just said, you know, there are a lot of interracial relations or intermarriage is going on.
Mm-hmm.
And she just answers, oh, but I looked in the dictionary and it was the longest word in the definitions. So I thought it was the more.
Oh, okay. We're now recording things, don't disturb us. We're about to finish.
Sorry.
We're recording.
Okay.
Okay, that's a really good point. Yeah, so sometimes the Chinese English learners, they tend to choose the words in the dictionary that are long.
Yes, it's like a bit of a competition going on.
Because the longer, the more sophisticated it might be, but without really fully understand how the word is properly used. Because some words has a negative meaning, positive meaning, or neutral meaning, or even some meanings related to racism, right? They need teachers to help them, to point them out.
Mm.
But
Or so it's an uncommon word, it's not a word that you would use normally.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
Or it's an old-fashioned word, it sounds like...
Yeah, we get that.
It sounds like, some words like it were from... I don't know, you're writing like a Victorian or something.
Some students may like, some teachers may ask the students to read some classic books. Books written by Shakespeare.
Right, okay.
Charles Dickinson's, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They wrote those words in the books, but more than 50 or even more than 100 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
But in their time, in those authors' time, may be popular, but in present days, those words are not that popular anymore.
Exactly.
Students shall really know that. In current days, some words are not that commonly used. Mm. You can read that, but we don't say that often, right?
And I agree. And I also like, even today, current textbooks, you know, that are a bit more modern than that. I still think in Chinese books, Chinese textbooks, like teaching grammar or phrases, they're still, to me, still a bit old-fashioned. And so I think it's what I like learning on this online project is I'm actually working with Chinese teachers for the first time.
That's good.
Which I'm really celebrating that. I really enjoy that because it's well needed. And I think in my experience up until now, mm-hmm. we never collaborate together. We don't, you know, brainstorm together. We don't, you know, write scripts together or anything. This is the first time.
Wow.
And I think it's been a positive experience for everyone, for the, the teachers, for the student teachers, mm-hmm. and myself, you know. So I think it's very, very important that we work together. As well, so we can understand more how Chinese teachers work, student teachers, because we don't know everything about the Chinese language or you know, the culture. We're still learning, you know.
Very good.
Going back to the dictionary, that you get the other extreme, that students don't look at the dictionary. So what happens then? They end up using the same vocabulary, the same words, mm-hmm. you know. So it gets a bit. Kind of a bit boring, right? Yeah. So it's like, so please encourage it. And then my student teacher said, well, yeah, but they're a bit slow. I said, maybe initially they're slow, but it takes practice, right?
Yep.
So the more they look in their dictionary, again, they'll become more efficient and learn more new words, and it will stay. And write them down. Don't just look in the dictionary, you know, write down your new words.
Yeah, use them in the writing or in spoken English. Yeah. Mm,
definitely, definitely. Good. And as regards for pronunciation, this is part of one unit in this online course. Mm-hmm. It's about a student teacher. She said she had a problem thinking that the students could not pronounce the word very well. And the word cola. For example, Coca-Cola.
Oh, Coca-Cola.
And she said she just kept on trying and trying with them, and they just didn't get it. And I said, well, first you can break up the word sometimes, break it down. Mm-hmm. So you can either speed it up, slow it down, because sometimes I find when I listen to them, they go, cola, you know. So change the rhythm, change the speed, the pace in it, and that works. Because for me, when I'm learning Chinese, mm-hmm. I'm really slow. But then when I get the grasp, I speed it up a bit, and then my tones are much better. I pronounce the words much better. Mm-hmm. So I think that can help too, the pronunciation. Mm-hmm. And also demonstrate how to pronounce the word, not just listen to a recording and given, you know, you're given instructions how to pronounce it, but nobody's there demonstrating to show you, and you know, where do you place your tongue, for example, in your mouth when you're pronouncing a word.
So, and also a way to test whether your pronunciation is correct or not is to talk to native speakers. Mm-hmm. Once they understand, mm-hmm. that shows your pronunciation is correct, they can understand you, right?
Yeah.
This is really the I think, in my opinion, it's the best way to test your pronunciation.
Absolutely.
And also there are different kind of pronunciations, American English, British English, Australian English, Indian English, you know, a lot of them, right? But certain pronunciations, they stay the same. But you can talk with you or speak English with your own characteristics. You still talk like you. Mm-hmm. You don't talk like someone else.
Exactly.
I know some Chinese English learners, when they speak English, they suddenly don't sound like them anymore. It's like a totally different person. Mm-hmm. It's like an impersonator. It's like suddenly you talk like Elvis. You talk like Michael Jackson. Mm-hmm. Okay, they choose a model. Okay, to talk like that. Oh, that is fine, but you don't have to be like that all the time. We hope you talk.
So I know what you mean.
Naturally, you talk still. Andrew, you talk like Andrew. Francesca, you talk like Francesca. When you speak another language, that's you. I can hear that. You have your own tone, your own style, right?
Mm-hmm.
So for me as well. But it's just one point I just brought out. I think that might be also useful to Chinese English learners.
Yeah, I think so, because some may sound like also affected. Like very, like if somebody's trying to speak British English, they go, hello.
Hello, how and do you do?
You know, and it doesn't sound very natural, you know. And also when you think, I believe I read in an article recently, there's maybe 2% now actually speak like the Queen of England, you know.
Oh, we'll continue. Oh, hello guys. Sorry, we had a blackout during the interviews, and the light just went off, went out, and we had to move to a new place to continue the interview. And what we were saying, like 5 minutes ago?
Yeah, we were talking about, from my experience, the first time I'm working with Chinese teachers.
Oh, yep.
Yeah, on this new project, which is great, because I'm learning so much from them. Mm-hmm. They're also learning a lot from me being native. And I think it should be encouraged, and it should continue that we should work together, you know, because understand each other's culture, and it's not just the language
exactly.
and how we work. So I mm-hmm. think it really should be encouraged.
They shouldn't be taught or shouldn't be teaching separately, right? They
exactly.
should really work with each other to put all the strengths together. Right?
Absolutely.
As for Chinese English teachers, they know Chinese, they know why certain Chinese English students make certain mistakes, the root of those mistakes,
mm-hmm.
right? But English teachers, the native English teachers, you know what words are commonly used, what are current commonly used words. So
uh-huh.
those are all your different strengths. If you combine those strengths together, that'll be really
mm-hmm.
beneficial to the teaching and to the teachers and also the students.
Definitely.
Right. Do you agree?
Definitely.
Yes,
yeah.
I agree. Maybe sometimes it's difficult to put in practice because
sure.
also
yeah.
as foreign teachers, maybe we are not there forever. Like
mm-hmm.
it's a bit like we end up staying several years, but it says right here it's a bit a transition part of our lives as opposed to people who are very rooted in China.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know, maybe it has the sense of that it's pointless to cooperate with people
mm.
who are going to stay a few years and then just disappear. Or I don't know, maybe it's something to do with self-consciousness, shyness. Yeah, I agree, cooperating should be really important
encouraged.
Should be
definitely. I think it's a
yeah.
win-win situation.
Exactly.
Like
yeah.
I say, as you said, in reality, it can be difficult. Like, you know, we have different schedules
yeah.
and responsibilities, and you know, so sometimes it's very hard to get together. But it can be done. If I'm working on this new online project, and I believe it's the first time
mm-hmm.
that I've actually collaborated with native teachers.
Yeah.
So I think it's a really positive thing. So even if, like you say,
we
won't
so
hear
too.
Or 2 or 3 years, it's still 1 year.
Yeah, yeah.
It's
yeah.
still 2 years, still
yeah.
3 years. It's something more
yeah,
than normally what we get.
Exactly.
You know?
There's still a lot, right? It can be done.
Absolutely.
Within
definitely.
That year,
yeah,
within
yeah, of course.
2 years,
even in 1 year,
yeah.
there's a lot that can be done.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much for sharing those with us. By the way, before we finish up here, you know, I forgot to tell you some good news
oh.
from our last video.
Okay.
I think you have seen the comments from our viewers and also the number of video views, right?
Yeah.
Actually, the video that we had broke a record. The number of video views has reached more than 4 million.
Wow.
So
wow.
that's
I mean, that's unexpected, and it's great because it's
yeah.
obviously people are happy with it. They need that kind of information, advice, and positive. And it's more about positive affirmation as well.
Exactly,
you know, be positive, you know.
So want to say something to the viewers out there?
Don't give up. Keep on continuing. You know, don't beat yourself up about it. People work at different paces in their life. Some work much quicker, and then they go, a bit complacent. Some people take a bit longer, like me, and then you grasp it, and you've got it. So just keep on at it. Keep on working at it. And thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate your positive comments and opinions, and hopefully we are of help. So thank you.
Good.
Francesca, wanna have some words to say to the audience?
Well, good luck for everything. And I have to say, I'm very grateful for the opportunity I've been given
mm-hmm.
by,
definitely.
I don't know, fate or luck, or I don't know what thing in the world, to be in China. Because it's really opened my mind very much.
Absolutely.
It's led me to meet wonderful people, to see wonderful places. So really, thank you, Xie, from the bottom of my heart.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. And also, the Chinese New Year is around the corner. So let's say Happy New Year to them.
Yeah.
Together,
yeah.
okay? Happy
New
Year!
Year.
See you next time.
Bye.
Bye-bye.